So, what is being a scientist? Experimentation? Changing your theory? Changing your model if you have to? Because there is no one great model which fits into everything. And you will use a bit of things, maybe after 1 year, the model will change. Because things keep changing. And you are babies, right? No? You are babies. Okay, I hope I'm not speaking to the AI robots here. So, if you were babies, what you used to do when you were a baby, you would take a piece of paper, put it in your mouth. What you are doing is experimentation there. And then you spit it out. And then you try to tear it out. And then when you had to ride a bicycle, you did not have such fear. Secret. Adulthood is a trap. Okay? So, but you can. You need to work on yourself and see how I can make my life better. And if you are babies, you are scientists. We just have forgotten what we were. And in the noise of all this world, everything, all the jargons, we don't know what we are doing with our lives. We don't know. I'm done.
Yeah. Santosh, that's 10 cents worth of. No, I'm just joking. All right, any other questions? Somebody else? Yeah.
Related to the industry now we have, right? By the moment we start doing more work in one particular technology, like even maybe the automation tools, right? And the leadership team would always looking for the buzzwords that we have to keep it and we should start adapting it. And towards the end, the person who is actually implementing those ideas of the leadership teams, it becomes like, okay, what am I doing here? For few days in your year, basically we will be going with kind of like maybe DevOps or CI/CD processes or whatever it may be. And later if industry is moving drastically to another set of new things, then we should keep following it. We should not have a question, okay, whatever I have done, is it giving a value add to the company, or at least is it making sense to me to put my effort into that? That is the basic question, not only to me, to most of the people who are working at the execution portion or the delivery team's point of view. So I don't know, maybe probably you can answer better from leadership point of view. Is it good always to go with the high standards of words that we maintain in the industry, and how much it is it applicable?
I'll give my 2 cents, but then, so this was, I tend to agree with you. It's like a Bollywood release, okay? Every Friday, a new film comes, a new script, and you get to watch it, okay? So technology has been changing almost at the same pace like Bollywood, or in fact, faster than that, okay? So, but yes, the only problem is if you don't go with the flow, don't do these terms or don't do POCs of whether it's Agile or DevOps or whatever new tools which has been done, the customer is the most interesting person. In fact, he is looking for these things to come from you, okay? Because he has gone to 6 places before coming to your place. And in the first place, he was told about a DevOps transformation. The second place, he's told about containerization. The third place, he's told about some microservices, some new things and all. You stand there and tell that you are just doing the same old things. Do you think your leadership team will back that order? So I'm just taking you from an operational issue to a business issue. So I think in business, you have to talk the language, which is the norm, which is in vogue or fashionable, okay? Whether you are implementing it or not, maybe that the customer will validate later. But I think, yes, you see your RFPs, you see your proposals, you see your slides. When I see the slides of my own company during customer presentation, I was doing customer success. Wow, such a great company. We do almost everything. Because everything has been put in the slides. All the architectures are there. Whatever came 3 weeks before, we have a slide on it. Got it? So this is customer presentation to get the order, okay? What's happening in the ground, obviously he will validate after a POC. So this is an issue. I think you have to keep pace, and leaders do put pressure, and being a leader, I have observed that. I agree with you.
I think also just to add to what Doc said, right, I think it's not bad at an execution level also to find out what's happening, right? How much of it do you absorb and you take within your project? You can always try for that, right? But not knowing, because I met a lot of people who don't know what's happening in that industry, right? They don't know what's happening or how DevOps and testing may change. I mean, if you are a student of testing, if even if you're working on, let's say, quote-unquote waterfall kind of a project or agile, which is waterfall in 2 weeks kind of projects, it is always good to learn about how others are possibly doing things better. So,
you had a question?
Over there. So we speak about domain knowledge, automation, and all. So I wanted to know if a team has an ideal ratio of manual versus automation, because one of you mentioned automation testers has head weight, and I have seen it. So if you need manual testers, manual testing to be done by these, it's not always possible. So is there kind of a ideal ratio one team has to have for manual versus automation? Because these days things are going microservices, but the business cases needs to be tested from application for every release. Release cadence being so quick, agile and everything, so it's become a challenge these days on this ratio. So
I must just say this, that you are seriously aiming for senior management. Okay, that's all I can say right now, but anyway, I'll leave it to the panel.
Ratio, I don't want to be a Sheldon in Big Bang Theory now. So I think it's hard to measure what's the ratio or everything. What we need to have is a diversified team. Coaching, practicing, mental health of the team, and speaking about it's an intrinsic motivation. We are only having an extrinsic motivation nowadays. I get a paycheck, I do this thing, I execute. We have to start doing it for our own integrity of how do I feel about my work? What can I do about it? Or I'm just the same, okay, tomorrow there is someone, okay, this guy knows automation, but where am I good at? Because I cannot compare an automation person with a person who is what you guys call as a manual tester. I call everyone as an engineer, how you think. So we need engineers, not the diversified team, like, okay, this is a manual tester, this is an automator, and there is some guy who is a... We all are a team. And when you divide, you know what happened when British was ruling us. Just cut that from the video, because I need to travel to London sometime. So when you are divided, people enjoy it. It's there in the psyche, from even from our ancestors as well. When you divide people, you become an authority. Automation is kind of authority. Even manual testing can be authority. Security can be an authority. There is no authority. And it's hard to measure with the ratio that, okay, you are three. Knowledge, all these different skill sets matter, and how you are coaching them. And what fits into the context, rather than, okay, it's 1:2. Well, both of them are crap. Now, where is this one guy? Where are these two guys? Well, they have this certification. Cool. But they can't do their job well. It's just like Doctor Strange's movie. I speak a lot about movies and Sheldon theories. It's about same thing, hard work, discipline, and practice doing it again and again, no matter what, and also being humble to someone else when someone has a different point. If someone says 1 + 1 = 3, you can say, tell me more, rather than saying you are stupid. Because maybe they have got a point. No one speaks about, okay, we went Plato when he said the earth is flat, okay, some other theories, there is time travel theory, and do we still know it? It's still a theory, because I haven't been to space and watched the earth from the space. Is it okay, this one? Because these are convincing theories, maybe. Plato also gave a convincing theories. Other guys would also give convincing theories. How convincing they are. That's what is going on. I think it's hard to answer that question in a straightforward way, like one statement, okay, this is what you need to do, because there is no one answer to it. I'm sorry.
Yeah, just because the easy answer would be that you're talking about quantity, and Santosh just said quality actually would matter more than quantity. A real example would be if anybody has a Mac laptop here, has opened Safari. Anybody wants to guess how many engineers it took to create that browser? It was done in 6-7 months by 2 people. One of them had joined only 3 months into that company. And one guy was actually a manager. So those 2 people sat down and actually created a browser, which actually, if you actually start reading through these kind of things, creating a browser is a very, very big deal. There are not many browsers in the world. There are not many operating systems in the world. And these things were done by a bootstrapped, small ragtag teams, very small teams. Why they were able to do was because they were technically very skilled, and they actually liked what they wanted to do. So the, any person who would have shallow experiences, it is very difficult for them to keep surviving this software changes in the world, because it's it changes too fast. And by the time you learn Perl, then Python comes. Like, there are people who started learning Perl back in the day, and by the time they learn Perl, something Java comes up. And then you learn Java, suddenly Visual C++ came in. Like, it's, you can't chase that, but you have to have the skills. So once you learn how to do that, actually somebody talked about, I'm touching about that topic as well in my talk, is rather than learning tools, development actually is not about tools. It's absolutely not about tools. That's actually the crux. If you look at any great engineer, designer, people who made iPhones, iPods, Android, anything, it's not about the tool. Even people who made Appium, like anybody who's in automation on mobile or web would know about Appium, Selenium. You talk to them, they will not talk about the tool. They'll all talk about the how they were solving a problem. Like, fundamental. But they can do that abstracted discussion only because they are really good in their skill. So that hard work is, there's no shortcut to that.
So Rahul, you gave a very long-winded answer to a very short, as compared to if Douglas Adams was there on this panel, he would have basically told her 42. That's it. End of story.
So I tell you, these metrics are very dangerous. They are good for management to get a customer. So I call it as lies, damn lies, statistics. So all the metrics we show, the customer was telling, your DRE is better than his, your escape rate is better than this. I was just wondering, they have taken our numbers so seriously. They're so serious about it, and they're comparing customers, and I'm going to get the order. They have taken all my metrics and all my data analysis. I can comfortably say that because I'm out of the industry now. So I was just thinking, we cooked all this a day before, and we have got numbers from a project which doesn't even have that amount fit to be a sample. And we are giving the data, and I'm getting millions and millions of dollars to my customer just by talking on the face of it. Okay, and they're comparing my data with another data, okay, which is itself not done well, okay, massaged. Okay, so now the message is this type of, this is a very good question she has asked. I'm talking about tested developer ratio. Okay, they asked me this question, and we, one day before we go to HR, we do that role, we calculate all that, a nice figure, 1:3, 2:2, something will come up. So nice, doctor, you have a right mix. We plan to give you the order. The wearer knows where the shoe pinches. The wearer knows where the shoe pinches. So that's life. So don't go by metrics. Rightly said, I think the best development is done by passion. You don't ask your mom, malai mar ke chai pilao. You ask your mom, chai pilao. Usme malai hota hai. You go to a shop and ask, malai mar ke chai pilao. Because you want the stated need and the implied need. But at home, you know it will be taken care of. So be a mom in your company. Be a dad in your company. Feel your company as part of it. Quality will come.
All right. Yeah. Sorry.
I can. So we have concept of pair programming and all. So how the productivity improves with the pair program, both testers and developers sitting next to each other, and will it really help for increasing the productivity or the deliveries and all?
What does Google say for that question?
So you want me to answer why is pair programming important? Sort of thing. Okay, so pair programming comes from driver-navigator principle, where the person who is driving a car always has a pseudo-driver also looking at the same dashboard. Okay, so when you're developing a piece of code, there are two sets of people, two pairs of eyes looking into the same code, understanding it so that the reviews on the fly, because when you're programming, writing a logic with a syntax and semantics, there's another set of eyes which is telling, okay, do this, do this. So that essence of getting a next level view is the fastest in that type of programming. So you want me to, is it good or bad you're asking or something? It's a good technique. It's a good pair programming, is no doubt a good technique. We follow it, but yeah.
I'll give you an example. I like cooking. And I like to experiment with my cooking a lot. My wife cooks all very well as well. So in theory, if we both are in the same kitchen at the same time, we should be able to cook very well together. Pair cooking, basically, right? But the truth is, we have a rule in the home. Only one of us can be in the kitchen at a time, right? So pair programming is like one of those things which, for example, test-driven development, right? This style of development, that X thing, that buzzword. As a rule, we can't do it. You have to try it out. If it works for you, it is good. Otherwise, it is not. Throw it out, please. But mostly what happens is management pushes it. Okay? TDD is great. I have met like two classes of great developers. People who love TDD, people who hate TDD. That, no, this doesn't work for me. So their greatness is not based on the system they use. So pair programming, productivity, if it is reducing, but was productivity your goal? Can pair programming be used as a training program? Books out there, agile books say, don't use it for training. Why not? It's a good way to train as well. Why only driver navigator? So these self-imposed rules are what is dangerous. That's what I call dogma. Don't be dogmatic about anything. And then everything would fall in place. Yeah? That ratio was not 42, by the way. It was 3:7.
I was planning to add 1:2, 3:7. But anyway.
So, all right, not Sharlar now. When I started testing, okay, pair testing was great, exploratory testing, okay, everyone said, okay, do pair testing. And I started doing it, and I felt bored. I started feeling that, bluntly I would say this, because I had a different source of information. I had a different source of information, and my knowledge was different. And the person who was paid to with me took more of my time. It was training rather than bringing in the knowledge of both of the people onto the product or project or anything to solve a problem. So it was a lot of wastage of time. It has to be a training program. And also when you're programming or testing or anything, the best thing to do is ask both of them, how do you feel about you? I mean, how do you feel about that person, how do you feel about this person with each other? It's as good as a relationship. A boyfriend, girlfriend, or a wife, or anyone who is into relationship. You care for each other. You want to know what works for me, what works for you. Or else you are throwing something here, okay, shit hit the fan, right? Someone will start screaming at you. So pair programming, many people want it to work. But I would say that get into as many errors you want. That's a way to learn. Not like, okay, in the first shot, I want to make it work. The more errors you get through, okay, you'll be good with it. And I wrote a buggy JavaScript, and it ended up in creating a software. I mean, I can call it a JavaScript program. And if this runs, the browser crashes. And people said it's a buggy program. Well, it crashes the browser. So I know I have created a software to crash a browser. It has a market in the darknet. Yeah, thank you.
So Santosh, what you're essentially saying is you need shaadi.com ka algorithm to find the right pair to program with.
Well, actually, Thomas Edison said this very nicely when he invented the electric bulb. He said, I made 3,000 electric bulbs. I know 2,990 ways how not to make an electric bulb. So that's, you know, if such people are saying, you know, don't have fear of failure, experiment, try, learn from each failure and keep moving, there must be something truth in there.
Right? Sure. Good one. Yes,
just because I had earlier given an example of pair programming not working, so I also want to say that for the same person with a different combination or in a different task, pairing could work. I actually enjoy pair programming. Okay, so I have a colleague who's like 5 years experienced, and the best of the software development which I do is when he sits next to me. It is the not driver navigator also. It's that, oh, you missed something there, or it helps, and it's like a sounding board. Okay, so that also helps. So just try out, but don't make a dogma out of it. That really hurts, really.
Just
okay.
One sentence?
No. Okay, one more question.
One. Shaadi.com thing. Yeah. Oh, no. I haven't put the period there. Shaadi.com, a counter joke for a joke.
Okay, you want a joke for a joke? Yeah, fine. I'm always good for jokes.
Well, the biggest thing is you adapt. You understand your partner. It's not about, okay, finding the right person. So you finding a programmer or finding a tester, okay, you can say that. Europeans do it really well, Germans. They say it directly that, I'm feeling that, okay, you're not doing the right thing to me. And now here, we think 1,000 times, we take 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, and then it gets lost. We don't communicate. If we communicate, you can solve it. Well, some relationships, it's a divorce, right? So you say, okay, I can't really work with you. And there are certain set of people. So if you want to go to shaadi.com, it can still happen that you will not be a right fit. So do, it's a context based, how you feel, it's an individual based, and resolve it if you can, or else don't work with each other if you want that thing. Sure. Whatever you choose, choice. I'm done.
Thanks.
One sentence.
Any other questions? There.
Goes to anybody who's willing to answer. So basically, I'm from QualiTest. My name is Purvika. Coming from a service-based company, we get a lot of requirements for SDET role, software development engineer and testing. But the customers who approach us, their definition of a SDET is extremely different. I mean, it's poles apart. So what is your take on it? Who, according to you, is SDET?
Okay. Yeah. I'm talking. What is the meaning of a software development engineer in test?
What is your definition of a software development engineer?
Chacha, what is it, SDET? As per me, so I didn't define it honestly. SDET was a terminology which is. So what we are trying to tell a software development engineer is that you are developing, you're doing your unit test, okay, and then you are throwing the code over the wall, the Chinese wall which was there, to a group of testers, okay? And the testers were using their system test, integration test, acceptance test, whatever type of test. Now, we are telling the developer that you shift, like the tester has shifted left, you're telling the developer, shift right, go a little more further than what you did as a unit test. Try to do that so-called, integration test or system test, try to get the whole flow of it. You're asking that guy who was on the extreme left to come in the middle, okay, on the chain, on the scale. So what is the scale? The scale is downstream and upstream. Upstream is your architects, your requirement gathering, your design, your coding and unit testing. Downstream is your system testing, deployment, pre-staging and all. So when on that scale in the supply chain, if you're asking somebody to go from upstream and come to the middle of the stream and not to the downstream, So you are trying to create a SDET type of a environment. That's my...
So that's basically what you're saying, Doc, is development should be a core skill, testing should be a secondary skill.
Secondary skill. Maybe when he's going to the right from the left, I think
okay.
he's going...
Anybody else?
Yeah, anybody else?
Some truth. It's just a designation. It is a designation which is given to people so that they don't resign.
So that, they work in it.
Yeah. Services companies have changed all their tester designation to SCT and SDETs. I also did that to get more business. They are still doing the same shit. Okay? With all due respect, I'm sorry for the word, but there is nothing called SDET or SCT existing. A services company in India cannot form a team of SCTs and still make money. That's the reality. Because if you pay them X salary, your expense is like 2.5x, that's the billing which you were doing. So if you are in an Indian services company, medium size, small size, and you are doing services business and you are sustaining, it means you're lying about that your team, that they are SCTs. Because SCTs would not remain at that salary. Try asking a developer to shift right. How many developers agree to that? So what you're doing is, because developers don't want to become testers, you are just makeshift work. That's the reality of most of the people who are calling themselves SDETs and SCTs. Okay? If your story is something different from that, I would love to hear that. But I think your claps tell me that somewhere there is a truth to it.
I think you yeah, kind of you. Summed it up. No. Unless you have a different point to add.
Oh, yeah,
I want to. Yeah? Yeah? Sure. Go ahead.
Thank you. All right. So the shift left approach, now people start from the left. I heard this in one of the conferences in Spain, and people are speaking about shift left. And I did not know. This happened just 1 year back. And then I went to a guy and asked, what is shift left? And he said, oh, you start from the design, you come here, this side. I said, isn't that normal that you had to do that from before? What is this new thing? And then I said, this is a new thing. Go and write it on Twitter, Facebook, everywhere. Shift everywhere, wherever you can. Done.
Okay, good. Thank you. Anybody else? 1 second, I'll just come to you. Anybody on that side? 1 second, we're dominating this side there.
Can I?
Oh, yeah, sure. Okay.
Yeah. Hi, guys. My name is Gan. A question which is summing up everything. We have talked everything here, answers, questions, and everything. So we know that, and as you said, that we need to push a bit more to learn everything. But as a QA managers, how do we encourage people to learn everything? Like, do we need to draw a line? Or is it necessary to draw a line? Or you know that we have told the fact. And let's talk about the truth. In the companies, we have a pressure to finish the things, right? We have a time constraint. So we cannot push the team members to do the things. Like, we need to push the team members, but we cannot push them to learn everything. So we need to draw a line there. So how do we do a quality thing there? Because we have a time constraint, right?
So thanks for the question. I think there is a misunderstanding. That was the remark, which I've been making this generalists when I said, right, that if that is what you are just a generalist who knows little bit about too many things, over a period of time, there is no career left in that. So you should specialize at least in one area. Okay, I'll give you an example. I'm a textbook generalist. Okay, I started my career in mechanical industry, of course. I moved to IT industry. I was a database tester. A manual tester, a GUI automation tester for 3 months, I moved out of that. I moved into performance engineering. I left that, I moved into security. Then I set up the first white box testing team of McAfee. Okay. Then I left that, I became an internal consultant. Then I left that part, I designed the first framework which across teams. I left that, I entered into entrepreneurship. So you see, I've been doing every 1 year, 1.5 year, I have started out as a fresher. And 15 years of doing that, you know what I can say to you? Those people who are trying to be generalist in 6 months, 5 months, doing 20 things parallelly, not worth it. So 2 years back, I moved out of performance. I no more mention performance engineering is my area. I no more mention the regular functional testing as my area at all. I thought I need to pick two and really be good at it after 15 years. So I'm not saying learn everything. I'm actually against it. You have to be exposed to everything. You have to empathize with others, but you can't learn everything. It's impractical.